What's up, everybody? Thanks for stopping by the Broski Dudes podcast. Today we have a fun-filled, packed episode for you, so stay tuned, check it out. Let me know what you think in the comments below.
All right.
What it do, Stevie? Stevie,
yo.
In the building, dear.
What's up, man? Just chilling out, getting paid. Not really.
Paid?
No, not really.
Not really, right?
Last payment I got was a stimulus check. But thankfully, you know, I'm working still, so I guess a little bit of money rolling in.
All right.
What do you think?
I'm here chilling. By the way, guys, if you hear some rain, there's like a fucking hurricane happening right outside my apartment, and I need to have my windows up because otherwise it's too hot. Because in Europe, air conditioners are something that, yeah, they don't believe in it. Then you tell them, like, oh, and they're like, what? That doesn't exist. They don't believe that exists. They're denials. In Europe, they are air conditioning denials. Air conditioners denials, bro. That's what it is. So whatever. If I was to close it, I'll be sweating more. As you can see, I'm a little bag of mayonnaise. So yeah. So if you hear the rain in the back, you know, use it to your advantage. It might be soothing.
Yeah.
If you don't hear any rain, because I was able to fix it on post-production, then this whole thing would just be super retarded for me to say.
Maybe you start
but
now. If you're able to fix it.
Welcome to the Broski Doodles podcast. My name is Kiko.
Stevie D in the building.
I'm leaving that shit in. Fuck it. You all gotta know how it is, you know?
Yeah.
It ain't perfect the first time all the time.
No. But I don't think it'll ever be perfect. And that's what makes it great, so.
Not with me and you, dog.
No.
All right. We're wasting the minutes. Check it out, guys. I wanted to talk to Steven and to all of you, of course, about a topic that I wouldn't say I'm passionate about it, but I've looked up into it a bit, and it's very interesting. And a recent presidential candidate actually was promoting it. It was the platform that he was going with.
Hmm.
So, yeah, the thing is universal basic income, aka UBI, aka $150 a month. Well, it's like $1,500. So
yeah, it's basically a stimulus check, right?
Yeah, that's what it is. It's every month.
Isn't
so you get like $1,000 or like $1,200 every month, right? But that's what, I mean, in basic terms, universal basic income, every citizen gets, you don't call it a salary, but a grant, whatever the fuck, you know,
for
every month, right?
For essentials.
And the number that they're using in the U.S., and this is a platform that Andrew Yang had, which was a presidential candidate for the Democratic Party, but he didn't make it, you know, far. I actually liked the guy. There were things that I wasn't too sure of in the universal basic income. But he at least seemed to be honest and seemed to be genuine. You know, he seemed to be like, he wasn't a politician, so he seemed to be like a great guy. But in any case, so universal basic income, we're looking at a government that collects taxes from all the corporations and small businesses. And then that tax is used to give each of the citizen, you know, an allowance. I guess that would be the best word an allowance. And you know, pretty much like, what do you think, before we get into the economics and even if it's possible, you know, number wise, because there is another discussion that I want to get to, like, what's the cost of this and is it possible? But let's just say it was, you know, everybody gets $1,000 a month, and let's make it simple. I think it's close to $1,200, but let's leave it at $1,000 just because it's easier to sort of do the math and shit. What do you think, Steve, if they were to implement this, right? And from now on, everyone got $1,000 a month. What do you think that would, you know, what would be the consequences? And I'm asking specifically, like, do you think that would make people be more motivated to do their projects? Or will you think people will become lazy and simply just be less efficient because they already got enough money to keep them alive every month? You know, like, large scale, is it something that's gonna, like, create good? or, you know, like, what do you think in general? Give me your thoughts. You know, it is a very vague concept, but just give me whatever comes to mind.
All right. Well, look, I think it's nice to receive money, right? People are not going to turn down free money. But you have different types of people in the world. That storm's pretty serious over by you. So, they're not going to turn down that money, but you have two people in the world, and you, just for, to make it very general, and there's plenty more types of people. There are the people in the world who are pushing this, and the people, when I started doing a little bit of research after you told me, to start looking into it, you have Mark Zuckerberg, you've got Bill Gates, you've got, the Virgin Mobile guy,
Branson,
this, you know, you have all these people, and you think, okay, these people made a lot of money, like a lot of money. You know, why would they be open after all of their hard work to be just saying, yeah, tax me more so that I can help those people, get off the ground? And it makes sense because they are entrepreneurial in their minds. They're visionaries, and their vision has brought on their wealth because they've been paid for their ideas. And they believe that, well, given the opportunity for those who can have their basics taken care of, that takes off a bit of pressure mentally so that they can chase their dreams, or they can don't have to worry about that part, right? That, you know, they can be more laser focused. There's a school of thought where, like Google or like Facebook, you know, they have these offices that
bam. You heard that?
yeah maybe.
Yo man, I might not make it till the end. Like, there's some serious shit happening here at the studio, dog.
Yeah.
I really hope that, because I'm pretty sure I'm oh fuck.
Oh no. We lost them, bro. Dang. That's wild. We lost Kiko.
What the fuck?
I'm gonna take this and keep it going, but you have those people who really will take advantage of this help, you know, and they will keep in their own world and space innovating. They're going to keep on going, and that's going to serve a great purpose. Without even getting into the economic possibility of it. But by large in part, there's going to be, I believe, in my honest opinion, that there's going to be more people who are more inclined to be happy where they are. You know, it's a happy life is a less stressful life. And what was it? There was this thing at Jimmy John's I read once that, like, it was a story of, oh, well, if you, you know, a capitalist is talking to a fisherman, and the fisherman is, you know, catches 20 fish a day and comes back, and 20 fish a day and comes back. And this one guy stumbles on him and says, well, look, I'm going to pay you to get more fishes. We get paid more. You'll have more money. And I think the fisherman's response is like, so I'm going to work harder, and I'm going to have less time, but I'm going to be able to provide for my family more, but I'm going to be away from them more, and I'm going to be, you know, and it just went on. And then he just basically tied it back and said, well, I'm happy now, and I don't personally need anything more. And I think we could debate whether it's laziness or not. I don't think in this particular story it is. The fisherman is just very happy doing what he's doing, and it doesn't need any more, because yo.
Yo, some real shit, bro. Like, fucking shit went mad, bro. I swear. Electricity went out, some shit. I don't know if this shit went out on the whole, like, block.
Dude, it sounded fierce.
Bro.
I'm continuing the story on my own, bro. I'm just gonna keep on going. You got something to say to the listeners? You're in the mic right now.
I'm in the mic. Yo, man. Guys, I'm still alive. I'm gonna see if I'll be able to make it before the episode ends.
Yeah.
So I'm trying to get back to you guys, but I'm in another dimension right now. Just give me a moment. I'm gonna check real quick, and I should be back in 15 minutes, all right?
All right, man. Do what you gotta do.
All right, guys, pray for me. I'm on the way.
Peace. That might have been a little bit too hot on the mic, but yeah, definitely. Look, man, we're just trying to bring you quality content. You know, we're not trying to get too crazy, but I think that if you're going to continue, or if you're going to have a UBI provided, you know, there is going to be obviously both sides of those scenarios that I was mentioning. You got those who will take their amount and reinvest, and there's going to be those who just take that and do nothing else. And I believe that the unfortunate part is being incentivized, because UBI goes a little further and says for every child, for every person, you're going to get this amount of money. And I don't think that's going to be right, because we already are seeing it with other entitlement programs, like, you know, welfare and things like that, where people just have, there are people who do truly need it. They need it, and it's 100% fine. You know, I'm good with that. Because not everybody is given an equal opportunity, you know, especially, you know, coming from different backgrounds and different financial homes, like financial their status, you know, at home, you know, and that's again a humanitarian issue. But there's going to be those who are incentivized to have more children and be living quite comfortably. And I really don't think that's what the program is intended for, you know? So there has to be a little bit of regulation, just more regulation. If you are going to even think about doing that, you know, or just tighten regulation on the ones that we already have, you know, Social Security is already on its way out. You know, it's going to be very, very tough. I think we got Kiko back. Yo. Oh man, you're full black. You're full like darkness. What do you got there? The whole town? Are you recording your audio? Because this is hilarious. Oh, you probably have the hamster. You probably have the hamster running around keeping your computer. Oh, you're on your phone. You're definitely on your phone right now. Oh, junk. Yeah, I hear you fine. I hear you fine. Dali. I'm recording, bro. Yeah, I got 14 minutes into the podcast, into this one. No, man. We have a duty to our listeners, man. All four of them.
Right now, the audio is not being recorded. Oh, I know how to record it with my other little...
Get the Zoom.
Okay, here it is. Got it.
It just as you were saying it too, like, wow, that's pretty serious. Click.
Yo, that shit was crazy. Okay, so now I'm recording audio. All right, I'm recording audio. Are you able to see me?
Yeah, I can see.
Very little?
I can see. Very little, but I can see you.
All right, well.
You're good.
If you can see me there, perfect, because I'm also recording the audio on a little recorder. So, bro, so regarding...
Let me bring you up to speed what I've said. Let me just... That's okay. We'll just do the little sound wave or whatever. Dude, I was just mentioning that I think personally, like, the program itself is going to be good for both sides if executed properly. But I do feel that I think that these entrepreneurial type of people are going to be able to reinvest or use this to help them get off the ground. But I believe that there's going to be more people who are going to just need it for basic life, you know, things. And they may probably will see more of an uptick on complacency. People who are just at home. And I went even further and said basically that you have not, UBI is not only just for people over age, but it is even for children, or at least the way that it's been proposed, right? And that's going to definitely incentivize more than it already has with other entitlement programs like welfare and things like that to have more children and stay home. And I just don't think that that's a good way to...
Okay, so you're saying that if this applies to children, then that is going to incentivize people to have children. Well, and that makes sense because that happens in Venezuela. In Venezuela, mm-hmm. they actually... The government tells the people that if they have more kids, that they're going to get more grants. And, you know, the government does that because he knows that he can gonna get voters and people that don't really know how to think and they're just going for the free shit. But that's the way that mm-hmm. they're able to get that shit happening, you know?
Yeah. And that's everywhere. I mean, who's, like I said in the beginning, who's going to say no to free money, you know? Oh, I got to do this? Okay. You know, so I don't think that it's a terrible idea. I'm not an economist by any means. I'm probably skipping over a whole load of stuff, and I understand why these big tech giants, Branson, Zuckerberg, you know, Gates, all of them, is because their technologies are, and they recognize that their technologies are taking away jobs. The processes are needing less and less people. And people are, I mean, if that's the direction where it's going, which it's not going to stop, they're going to need to step in. The government's going to need to step in for a lot of the, you know, the blue collar work, the trade work and things like that. But I think that there just needs to be more regulation, a lot of regulation that would assist in the opportunity for people to be incentivized to work. Because, you know what I mean? Like, yeah, okay, you lose your job. Okay, but you know, in order to gain this, you have to not have more than six months of non-employment, you know, or something like that. I don't know. I mean, like I said, I'm not an economist, but it would have to be some kind of time limit on there. So.
Okay, well, camera is back, so I'm recording camera and also the audio. So this is where the problem comes in, because there is already a stimulus program, so to speak, like in the sense of there's already welfare that exists. So if you add the UBI on top of the welfare, I think that you're fucking up, because mm-hmm. it's too expensive. Now, mm-hmm. the numbers that I saw were that every year the U.S. Collects about 3.7 trillion dollars from taxpayers, right? Mm-hmm. And it has to spend, or it spends, 4.1 trillion on its expenses, right? Most of it having to do with welfare. So there's already a deficit. Every year, it's sort of like the U.S. adds more to the credit card because the amount of money they collect is less than what they spend, right? So, mm-hmm. with that in mind, I did a calculation that I checked online on sources that are reputable. I don't have the specific links right now, but pretty much what he said is that if you were to give everyone $1,000, $1,000 or $1,200, it's either or, in the U.S., mm-hmm. then you end up with a total expense of $3.3 trillion a year. Meaning, if the government collects 3.7 from taxpayers, they're able to pay this UBI with 3.3, and they still have 400, million left, or billion left.
Billion.
For whatever else, they have extra, right? Now the problem is, some people are like, oh, I don't want my welfare taken away. But the thing is, the biggest expense when it comes to welfare is the policing of the fraud. So like, if you have disability, for example, you get a paycheck, right? But then you also need to pay for administrators to administer the service, and you need to pay for special people, normally third parties, that check that these people are not doing fraud to get the disability check, right? So my view is that, I mean, I don't know if I'm 100% with UBI, but the only way that I think UBI could work is if you give everyone, like I said, $1,000 or $1,200 a month, which cost about $3.3 trillion, which we can afford with the taxes that we collect now, and you eliminate all of welfare, all helps, and then everyone, the individual, will use the $1,000 for the things that they find are important. So let's say you have a disability. Well, now you have enough money to pay an insurance or a chiropractor for you to do whatever it is that you need to do. Or you're a single mother. Well, now you don't get food stamps or whatever. Now you have $1,000 that you can decide what you're gonna spend them on food for your kids, on this and that. You know, like the person that has a problem with health. Well, with $1,000, I'm pretty sure you can get a good insurance. And so that you can. So what I'm saying is, even though I don't agree with UBI, and I'm going to get to the reasons why I don't, it's more of a moral thing. Technically speaking, if we're going to do it, it has to be done this way, so that it is fair, so that everyone gets it. That's the only way to make it fair. And if you don't have any issues, then you can save that money and then use it to your improvement. But if you do have financial problems, then you can use that to cover whatever your welfare is already covering now. It's just that the fact that the welfare has to be provided by this whole bureaucratic system, it makes it that half of the money that goes into it gets lost in just paperwork. Instead, if you just give the people the money, there's no administrative cost lost, so everybody wins. The government spends less, and the citizens get more.
Yeah, I agree with you. And I want to give you the opportunity to talk, because I've been ranting and talking our viewers' ears off for a little while. But I do think that one point I would want to touch on there is, you know, maybe if it's somebody with a health issue, you know, that would like a better insurance, they would have to be able to offset that, maybe living with someone. You know, that everybody would basically have to find a way to make it work, live with someone so that the cost of living can be shared. And, you know, because obviously if you have really good insurance, like, where's the rent money, right? Where's the food money? So you kind of just have to play that game. Or if the government strikes a deal with corporations or groceries, that they're able to do, EBT or food stamps along with this. And maybe these are calculations that should be taken into consideration. So that way, again, the essentials, the basic income is taken care of. I don't know. That was my only little tidbit, but I want you to go into your next thing, 'cause I'm at 24 minutes.
All right, so this is what we're going to do, because I want to get into like the technical parts of it and to see your opinion on the moral level.
I'll hit it again.
Yeah, hit it again. All right. Yeah, you so that people know, bro. We're recording this shit guerrilla style, bro. This is insane, bro.
Yeah.
Right now I have no light. Insane. Everything's crazy. You got the virus going on. A fucking storm. No light. I'm like, what the fuck is happening? Is the world ending right now?
It feels that way. It feels that way, man. There's too much stuff going on. But we had that here the other day too. It was just insane. My lake, you can usually see like the sand on the corners, and now you see nothing. You just see like the water level is raised, like heavy, and this is a big lake.
Oh yeah, over there you guys got flooding. I mean, like, is the world gonna end, bro? But now this is what I wanted to get to now with the UBI. Let's say that technically speaking, it works. Do you think it makes sense what I say?
Yeah.
Like, if you give everyone 1,000 and you take off any other help that they had, then everyone should be able to resolve their situation with those $1,000. You're not going to live on $1,000, but if you have a shitty job, an extra $1,000 can be that changing factor for paying that insurance or that, childcare bill that you mm-hmm. need to pay that you don't have money for. So does that make sense to you?
Absolutely. Yeah. No, I think that would be a very fair, more fair way of distributing funds and not accounting for loss of this money, right? Like you said, it was lost in the paperwork. So I don't agree with it, but so no, I think you're right. I think
so. Taking into account that technically it could work, right? That way, let's go into the moral part of it. Do you think that, mm-hmm. Because you mentioned something, kids are included, right? And in a way, you're like, well, if a kid gets $1,000 and they put it in some sort of pension, not pension plan, but savings account that maybe makes a little bit of interest, by the time they're 18, they might have $25,000 that they can use to maybe start a business and shit. So I can see many positives out of it, right? Now, do you think that more positive will come out of it than people taking advantage of it and at the end not being motivated, because maybe if you make $1,000 between you and two other friends, you can rent a cheap apartment and just play Xbox, smoke weed, eat cheap food, and sort of, because I'm pretty sure like with $1,000, if you get between 3 to 4 homies, you can get a cheap apartment and pretty much live off that and not do anything, you just play video games. Like, what do you think could be the moral route that people take in this if they were given that option of the UBI?
I think that would happen more often than the positive side of that. I think more people would be inclined to find a way to cheat the system than people who would use the system to their advantage for a positive outcome. I think there would be more, aside from the children aspect, if it was just a couple of homies living, you know what I mean? I do believe they would just be hanging out. They would have a job if they cared, or not have a job, or, do whatever. I mean, there are going to be opportunistic people who take the money and they'll learn, I don't know, they'll buy things and sell them on the corners. If they've had like a prior record or something where getting hired is not the easiest thing to do, but you're just trying to turn your life around. But the problem is that there's dense populations of people in this same situation, and those areas that are just fully concentrated with similar situations are going to be a very difficult, it's just going to be very, very difficult to ignore that. There's just too much in Detroit and in parts of Miami and New York, LA, you know, I would love nothing more than everybody to have a job and you know, provide for their families and provide for themselves. But just human history shows us that there's a large population out there that just want to kind of coast. So,
okay, but in a way, the alternative. Okay, so you're saying that overall, it will be a net bad because it will enable people that just want to coast to not do shit.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not speaking for everyone, but a lot of people.
Yeah.
Okay, now let me be the devil's advocate here. Would you say that those same people that you say will just coast and not do anything and just stay home and smoke weed will be the people that in today's world end up in jail, end up homeless, and end up costing a social cost to society and to the government anyways, and that maybe by having that UBI, even though they're not gonna be productive and let's just say they're just leechers of the system, at least it's better if they just stay in their house smoking weed, spending their $1,000 on their food and their Xbox, and that's it, instead of having a homeless drug problem in California, you know, or criminals in the streets. Or do you think that even with the UBI, there's still gonna be people that are gonna wanna be greedy and be criminal and shit, so it's not really gonna make a difference?
I don't know if it'll make a difference. That's gonna be my opinion. I think that there's gonna be people on both sides of that. There are gonna be people who are current users of these products, you know, the drugs, the alcoholism, and they're gonna turn around and use that money to fulfill that habit or that addiction. There's gonna be those.
Would you say that's better than maybe than them stealing to get that money? I mean, I'm not saying I don't agree with you. I'm just trying to poke the argument at all angles to see what's the realness out of, you know?
I don't know. I mean, I would like to know what's the current theft rate in relationship to those who are homeless. I mean, if that's even a way to blend those two numbers, I think that would be kind of a very over, you know, kind of a big picture thing. But I think, yeah, I mean, if you have money, you're less inclined to steal if you have money. So that you that's a good point. But $1,000 goes quick, you know?
No, it ain't. This is my other situation with this. And this is where I start finding the little holes. Like, what about inflation? Like, $1,000 is not going to be $1,000 in 20 years. So you're going to have to raise it, right? And how much do you raise it? And it's just going to become like another topic, like the minimum wage. Like, we should raise it more. I find issues with that where, like, I mean, maybe you could do it with gold. You're like, okay, everybody gets an ounce of gold, but it keeps its value. But the government wouldn't want to do that because they're always going to be sneaky fuckers, and they know that if you put gold, it's going to keep its value. But if you leave it at dollars, they can print money and then devaluate that and make it easier for them to pay that. So $1,000 can become $200 in 10 years, you know, when you really use it. Here's another factor, right? Like, let's say, okay, from today forward, how many people live in the U.S.? Okay, there's this many. How many? 400 million. Damn, that many? Yeah, we're counting all the illegals, everyone that's here right now. Everyone stays, everyone's legal. All right, how many are they? 400 people. All right, from now on, we're going to start giving these people, everyone, $1,000 a month. And we eliminate all of the welfare, right? So, technically speaking, it should start working because the taxes that are already being paid are enough to cover, that if you eliminate all the welfare, right? And you even get some money back, okay? So you do that. Now, what happens when new people come to the country? Do they also get the benefit? You know what I mean? Because this is a very...
That's a good point.
It's a very good point. Like, and this is the problem with welfare in general.
Because at the end, UBI is a way of welfare. I think it's a simpler form of welfare, and it's the one that I would prefer if I had to choose, but it's still a type of welfare. What happens if an immigrant comes from outside? Does he automatically have the right to also receive this? And then wouldn't that make it so that more people would want to go to that country? And then eventually so many people move there that they dilute the amount that people get, because you cannot just keep creating money. You know what I mean? So like, or do the new people that come in have to sort of first live there for 10 years and provide enough taxes to then be eligible? Like, there's many technicalities that could happen, you know? But it is very important to notice that when you have a welfare system that includes all with no restrictions, it fucks up real quick, because then people from outside come. And if people from outside have the same right as someone that has been there their whole life, paying taxes their whole life, and someone from outside has the same right as them to use public facilities, then eventually those facilities will not have the quality that the person that has been there their whole life deserves to have. Does that make sense?
Yeah, yeah. I mean, and the same can be said about new people being born. You know, more people are being born in the United States than people are dying day to day. Now, that's not the case globally, but you know, with enough time span, yeah, there are more people. Population is growing. There's no doubt about that. So,
I mean, the problem is not that the population grows organically, even at a fast rate, because those people end up working and bringing more riches to the country. I'm talking about people that come from outside specifically for the purpose of not being productive and just leeching from the government. How do you know? Because then you get to the talks of like, okay, if you regulate it, then they're going to be like, oh, so you're racist. So because the Mexican wants to come through, he doesn't get the $1,000. It's like, well, I mean, who gets it? Because who deserves it? I mean, that's what I'm saying. If everyone gets it, then eventually there's not going to be anything to be gotten, you know?
Yeah. No, I agree. I think that's also going to promote like very, very strict immigration laws. I think that that's kind of going to close our borders, because that topic is going to come up sooner than later, you know? So, then I don't know how much of a divide that causes in the world. When now you have a family member who lives in a different country and you're able to bring them over because they're your husband or they're your parents or even your child. But then this happens. Now, where do you go from that? You're caught in the middle. You're caught in the middle there. So I don't know. It's going to be really, really interesting. I just want them to kind of buckle down a little bit more on the entitlement programs that we currently have, the food stamps, because these are things that can be discounted and can be negotiated within in-house. You know, when you start putting a dollar on it, you know, yeah, you have to account for inflation and things like that, but then how do you take the other thing away without causing...
What are you saying, that you wouldn't take off food stamps?
Well, I mean, food stamps or some form of being able to purchase food is going to be necessary for
right,
those.
Right, but what I'm saying is, if everyone gets $1,000 a month, if your struggle is finding food, then now you got $1,000 to buy food. Yeah. So you don't need the food stamps.
But what if you have food stamps currently, right? You have food stamps currently, but you need $1,000 for medical expenses.
Okay, so you're saying like people that have... that are enjoying entitlements that are over the amount of what the UBI would provide.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, they're already double dipping. You know,
right? Okay.
Because people make a living off of this. They do this.
I mean, the people that are double dipping, you're gonna have to do it in a gradual way, obviously, but you're still gonna have to regularize those people eventually. I mean, to be honest, I'm too stupid to like tell you the mechanics of how this would work on a legislative level. But all I'm saying is, if we're gonna have any sort of welfare, it should be a fair one, and this I think will be the most fair one. But there's many holes that you could find. Like, okay, what if new people come to the country? Because new people come to the country all the time. Are they all included, or are they only included when they start paying taxes? I mean, dude. And sometimes you cannot have these talks because people say like, oh wait, well, what are you saying? Like, what do you mean by that? It's like, no, I'm just talking about realities. These are things you need to speak about to figure the fuck out and set them up correctly so that it benefits people the most that it can. I mean, that's the whole point of debating and fucking talking about ideas, you know? I don't know. I thought this was a cool topic, the UBI, because, you know, the main reason to support it, Andrew Yang, at least the presidential candidate, supported it mainly because he says that eventually in the next years, automation is going to kill many jobs such as trucking, you know, cashiers, you know, any, you know, think about anything that could be done by a computer, right? Mm-hmm. And then this leads me to another topic. He says that a lot of people are going to be left out of jobs, and because of that, we need to have a universal income system so that people don't die of hunger and shit, right? But the way that I look at automation is, automation has happened throughout history of mankind all over the place. Back in the day, you needed to have 100 people on a farm so that they could pick up all the shit, right? All the fruits, all the vegetables, right? And then somebody invented the combine in, you know, late 1800s or, and then now you didn't need 100 people, now you needed 3 people in this combine, and you were able to pick up all the, you know, do the whole process, right? So that meant, technically speaking, that 100 farmers are out of jobs, right? Because of automation. But what ended up happening was, well, those farmers learn how to do something else, or maybe learn how to drive the combines and shit, but they got on with the progress. And this is a debate that I think is valid. I mean, there's arguments on both sides, but I think that when an industry gets taken over by automation, like many did when the computers came about, you know, now you do everything online, that only adds to progress. And the people that were doing those jobs before that we don't need anymore because they're obsolete, well, they're better off not doing them, because that's going back. It's better for them to now learn a new task that's actually valuable in today's market and keep growing as a person. So that's the way that I look at it. Like, I don't think automation is bad. You know what I mean? And part of why automation is going faster in the retail business is because you have a lot of people talking about the minimum wage should be higher. We actually had a podcast, it's never been released, about the minimum wage. We should have one soon. I think we're going to have a minimum wage podcast soon with many facts. I want to research it well. But pretty much what I was trying to say is that you keep raising the minimum wage, eventually McDonald's is like, all right, if I have to pay you $15 an hour, I'm just going to pay this company to put these computers here that can take an order. And yeah, they're expensive, but after 1 year, I pay them off and that's it. I don't have to pay any employees. So you just incentivize McDonald's to fucking automize your ass. So now, is that bad? Well, I mean, if a computer can do it, then maybe that other person can learn how to do something else that a computer cannot do and move the fucking line forward. Like, I hate when people justify jobs just for the sake of a job. Like, well, but now cars can be driven automatically. Yeah, but then isn't it better for the guy to drive it so that he has a job? Well, no, that's fucking retarded. We have a machine that does it. Now he can do something else, and we can move the bar forward in technology. That's my view of it. I don't know, people might disagree, and I think we can debate about it, but that's how I look at it. That's how I feel that should be seen as. Like, progress is progress, and I can never go against it.
Yeah, no, move the needle forward is always a good idea, rather than saying stagnant, because like everything stagnant will eventually devalue, period, just everything, because we're a progressive society and we need to keep on progressing, and the more that we progress, the better people's lives can happen. You know, people before the internet didn't have the opportunity to make lots of money, and now they are, and they could have very well been a blacksmith or a farmer or whatever, but they didn't have that opportunity because there wasn't enough jobs in that field, so they adapt. The humans don't give themselves enough credit, I feel. They don't. They just don't like change, and that's for sure. So embrace it, you know, try something new and go for it. If it doesn't work, you got, you know, a whole lot more time in your life to keep on figuring it out. In the meantime, you got, you know, the government, who at the end of the day will figure out a way to help you provide for your life. You know, if you're low income, there's programs. If you're a disabled person, there's programs. If you got 18 kids, there's programs. So, you know, be smart and adapt and change, you know? No, you know, at the end of the day, I don't think that the government wants its people to be, our government, US government, doesn't want people to be oppressed. They want people to get to work. It's going to benefit them.
But I think welfare system, in some cases, is not helping. It's not moving the bar forward. Yeah. And I think this UBI thing is a better solution.
Yeah,
because you pretty much you take off the middleman, and there's a lot more money that actually gets to the places that need to reach. But I kind of just wanted to talk about this in a general way, because none of us are economists or politicians, so I really have a monkey's view on this topic. But, you know, I like to express what I think about it, and I wanted to sort of pick your brain and see what you thought about it. You know, people that are listening, I really am interested to know what other people think, like, because I really want to gauge what it is that people value when it comes to a society, and if that is something that they think could incentivize them to be better, or if it actually could fuck them up, you know, because there's people that could argue that if you don't have to struggle, then you're never going to fucking get out of your comfort zone and really push for it, you know. There is an argument to say that, look, man, if everything was given to you, if you didn't have to, like, live outside and really, like, get your shit together to progress, then, you know, then maybe it's not...
They wouldn't.
Yeah, maybe they would. So, but at the same time, who knows, you know?
What I do know is that I hope you get your power back pretty soon.
Yeah, for real, dude. This is crazy, man. I cannot believe this shit happened in Venezuela. The electricity will go all the time. You wouldn't have electricity half the time, or water. And now, doggy, I have like candles and shit. I feel like I'm in Venezuela again, when when shit was going crazy, you know.
Post-traumatic stress.
So yeah, that's what's up, bro. So I think that's enough for now for that topic, and I just wanted to see what you thought, man. And I'm glad that you gave me some good answers. I think we can have a second episode in the future when we have a bit more knowledge and when we have other countries that try it. But thanks for listening, even here in the dark. I hope it wasn't too much of a hassle that. I don't know what the fuck is happening, and I might not be in the next episode, to be honest.
you will be memorialized, I promise.
All right, broski. Take care, broski doodles.
All right, broski doodle. Love you, man. Take care. Be safe.
Hey, guys. Thanks for stopping by the Broski Doodles podcast today. We hope you had a lot of fun listening to it. We had a lot of fun recording it. If you like what you heard, go ahead and smash that like button and hit us up on all of our social handles. Leave us a comment so we can talk to you online and figure out what else to talk about online. So, yeah.